Hello. Today we are talking about underhyped books that I have read in the last 18 months or so, really like into 2019 and then 2020. I am so excited to be talking about these books because obviously if they fall in this list, they are books that I feel like have not gotten the attention that they deserve. Either I feel like they're underhyped because I feel like they deserve more attention than they seem to have gotten, or I feel like they may have gotten a lot of attention, but they are so good that I feel like the limit does not exist in terms of how much attention they really like deserve. So, some of these I don't think are like obscure picks, but I still think that they are underhyped because I think they deserve even more praise and attention. And obviously most of these are published by kind of like mainstream presses. So in that sense, like, you know, they've had major releases. They're not completely unknown, but I just think that they deserve even more attention, okay? That's why they made this list. So we'll start with a book you guys have heard me talk a lot about, and that is Ring Shout by P. DeJelly Clark. This book is one of the most impressive novellas, really, like, or short novel, that I have ever read. It is absolutely astounding to me how much action, character development, world building, and themes Clark packs into so few pages. And now that I've read more in his work, I can tell you that that is just like what he does really well. Like, this is just him being so good in terms of like how masterful of a short story teller he is. And I think this is also just really timely in 2020 because it's basically like literalizing American racism as like an evil magical force. So just all around, this book was so timely in its release and so good that even though it has gotten, I think, a good deal of attention, it deserves more. Similarly, I do think that Spoiler Alert from Olivia Dade got a good amount of attention when it came out, but I think that this is an absolutely fantastic version of what it's trying to do, which is a fake dating trope, which I'm an absolute sucker for. And also, I want to say in particular, like, the fat rep in this. I did a live panel with Bethany from Beautifully Bookish Bethany and Ashley from The Bookish Realm, and as we were talking about, like, what makes good fat rep, particularly in romance, but just in general, it made me appreciate how well Olivia Dade did that in this book even more, because I think it is really hard to do and like pull off well. Also, shout out to this cover actually having an apple-shaped plus size body on the front of it. So like, that's awesome. And then this is just really fun. I think that this gets fandom culture right. I just love this, it's so good. So it did get a lot of attention, but I just think it deserves more. The Light Brigade by Cameron Hurley, I don't think that this like flew under the radar when it came out in 2019, but I haven't really seen people talking about it since then. And that makes me sad because this was one of my very favorite books I read last year. And I just think as like a standalone version of sci-fi, this is like one of my go-to recommendations for people because it does time travel better than I think most sci-fi I've read does. And it's like a military sci-fi, but I don't think it gets bogged down in a lot of the like tropes of that genre that I don't always love. And I also think that thematically this is really interesting, and it does this thing where it purposefully disorients the reader, which is something that I really love. I just think that this is a super successful standalone sci-fi, which was very heavy thing to say, but I just do. I really, really like this, and I think that this deserves more love. And then this next one, I'm gonna say this is my pick for like, I wish this had been the book that had been getting hype instead of a different series, and that is In the Hall with the Knife by Diana Peterfrond, which is a Clue adaptation, this trilogy of YA mysteries is. I wish that this was getting, or like had gotten the same push or hype that the Maureen Johnson, what was that one called? The Truly Devious book, that trilogy. I just think that that trilogy kind of fell flat by its end. Whereas this one, I've only read the first two books, to be fair, because the third one's not come out yet. But so far, I think that this is a much more satisfying version of a mystery for like a YA audience than what Truly Devious ended up being. Both of them have like an elite boarding school setting. Both of them have mystery in the present, mystery in the past happening. There's a lot of parallels between these two series, and I just frankly think this one is better. So I wish that it was the one that had gotten that same kind of push. Then a lesser known book from the golden age of detective fiction that I have been pushing on people in the last couple of years, and that is An English Murder by Cyril Hare. This is just like, if you are looking for an isolated close circle mystery with snowed in vibes and like that golden age of detective fiction kind of country house setting, I just think that this is a super good version of that and well worth seeking out. I had not heard of this until I just happened upon it in a bookstore in London. Like, it was out on a table and I was like, oh, that looks, I see an isolated house, I see snow, I bet this would be something I like. I also love the dripping, like, I love the cover treatment of this. But anyway, I just think that if you're looking for that kind of a mystery, this is a great version of it. And I need to get my act together and read some more from Cyril Hare because I also really liked his writing. Next, Katie Wilde. I think Katie Wilde probably qualifies as underhyped in general, but I think in particular, her contemporary Christmas novellas are slept on. So I just wanted to mention this one, Secret Santa. There's one called All He Wants for Christmas. There's a couple of them, and I think that they're just really good versions of Christmas romances. I just really like the way she does them. She does this thing where she has, in all of her books really, women for the heroines in the relationships are often the ones with either social or structural power, and then she does interesting things with that. I don't know, I just think she deserves more love. So if you are looking for a nice indie romance author for some Christmas sexy times, I definitely recommend her, give her a try. On a much more serious note, I've got No Visible Bruises, What We Don't Know About Domestic Violence Can Kill Us by Rachel Louise Snyder. This was, I think, my third, like one of my top books of 2019. This was like definitely in my top five. I wanna say this was my number three pick. I think that this is an absolutely fantastic version of like narrative nonfiction that does sort of nonfiction genre blending between journalism, reported nonfiction, but also some like sociological nonfiction and like following specific stories. It also has some true crime elements in it. It's a really interesting book just in terms of its form. And I also think the subject matter is super, super important. So I would love for this one to not be a nonfiction that kind of fades away after a couple of years. Like, I hope that this sort of finds its place long term, because I think I learned a lot from it, and I just think it's super well executed in terms of it as a book, as well as the content being fantastic. Then a memoir that I really enjoyed last year is from Daniel Mallory Ortberg, who now is known as Danny M. Lavery after his marriage, and that is Something That May Shock and Discredit You. I think that this is such an interesting memoir. It's unique. I've not read a lot of memoirs like this, and it really is a lot of his exploration of his trans masculine identity in theological terms, because I'm biased in terms of we have a similar background of like fundamentalistic evangelicalism. So like that's the world he comes out of, and that's kind of how he approaches a lot of conceptualizing his own story. So I just think that this is a really thought-provoking, funny memoir. I don't know that this worked 100% for me 100% of the time, but I didn't feel like it got enough love last year. And I hope it's one that doesn't fade away, because this one like stuck with me. And I think if you're looking for a different kind of memoir that's funny and incredibly literate, like it's very dense in its references to biblical and literary canon, it's a super interesting memoir and one that I hope doesn't fade away. Then a classic, and I always hesitate to put classics on lists like this because it's like, well, how can a classic really be underhyped? But I think there are ones that it's like, okay, yeah, like this has got a Penguin like a Penguin classic edition. Like, yeah, okay, it's remembered, but it's not getting talked about the same way that other books of its era are. And I really loved Loving by Henry Green as a great example of stream of consciousness. Like, this is one of my favorite versions of stream of consciousness writing I've ever encountered. I also think it has a really compelling upstairs downstairs kind of plot and vibe to it. It's taking place in this Irish castle that has English landlords or like English lords in it, and it's during World War II. Yeah, I just thought that this was really a really great version of stream of consciousness literary fiction that I don't think gets a ton of rep anymore, but it is worth seeking out, in my opinion. And then the last one I have in physical form, this is Nothing Is Wrong and Here's Why by Alexander Petri. I frankly wish that this book had gotten the hype that Trick Mirror by Gia Tolentino had gotten last year. Like, I think this is a much more interesting collection of essays. Now, granted, different projects, this is much more overtly satirical and like very dark and very funny, but I just think this, I think, has got a better chance of standing the test of time in the way that people talked about Trick Mirror being destined to do. I'm like, I don't know that Trick Mirror is that book, but I think Nothing Is Wrong and Here's Why could be that kind of a like seminal satirical essay kind of collection. So I don't know, I would put my money on this before Trick Mirror in terms of which ones I think have a better longevity prospects to them. And then a few that I don't have in physical form. So first I had The Widow of Pale Harbor by Hester Fox. I think Hester Fox is doing a different kind of book than I'm seeing published, at least in like traditional publishing. Like it's different than what is mostly happening in traditional publishing right now, because they are gothic romance mysteries that I would say are as much mysteries as they are romance for the most part. Her most recent one in 2020, I don't think was her strongest book, but The Widow of Pale Harbor is the one I put down. I really liked that book. I think she evokes atmosphere excellently. And if you are looking for something that's like spooky light, that's got a lot of, you know, foggy seaside paths in New England in the 1800s, The Widow of Pale Harbor has like a Edgar Allan Poe inspired serial killer plot to it. They're interesting from a genre perspective. And I also think they're really well done and really satisfying if you like those elements. Two more nonfictions I wanted to shout out. One is Dying of Whiteness by, I believe, Jonathan Metzel. I just think that this is a really good look into sort of like the white rural experience from a nonfiction lens, much better than things like Hillbilly Elegy or some of the ones that have gotten more hype than Dying of Whiteness did. Like, I think Dying of Whiteness actually has some like real insight into the sociology and psychology of what is happening in white rural American life and like what white identity increasingly means in those groups. So I just think that that one deserves more hype because I think it's actually talking about an issue in a way that is neither patronizing nor coddling, and I appreciate that tone he strikes. And then What's Your Pronoun? This came out last year, and I really wish that this had gotten more hype because I thought this was a super interesting history of ideas, basically, or like history of grammar, and basically talking about how the English language has been searching for a singular gender-neutered pronoun for hundreds and hundreds of years. Like it's been discussed as, quote, a missing word by grammarians for hundreds of years, and how the use of they as a singular personal pronoun that is gender neutral actually has a very long history within the English language. Shakespeare used it, Austin used it, and I think he goes into both like the grammar aspects of it, the history aspects of it, and the political aspects of pronouns in a way that I think is just really interesting and compelling. And I was surprised it didn't make more of a splash last year because I feel like it's the kind of narrative nonfiction that's really timely, but also super well done and very readable. Like if you're looking for a good narrative nonfiction audio, this would be a good one. And I will end with two romance series. So first, Noelle Adams, who I just think is generally very undersung contemporary romance author. She is self-pubbed, but I just love her. I just think she writes really good, interesting, thoughtful contemporaries that feel real in a way. I think there's not as much fantasy in her contemporaries, and maybe that's why not everybody connects with them, but I just think they're really solid, smart contemporaries. And I think particularly she had this college series over the last couple of years that I really enjoyed. It's all centered around this sort of private liberal arts university in this small Virginia town, and it had a bunch of different tropes. It had like workplace, it's all centered around workplace, so there's always that element, but it's like friends to lovers, enemies to lovers, boss employee, like there was a ton of different tropes, and I think that she did them all really nicely. I really like that series. I thought that it was, I think she's perpetually an underloved fave of mine in romance. And then finally, I love Ruby Dixon and all things, but of people who already love Ruby Dixon, I think that the Corsair series from her is seriously underloved. I'm glad that it's getting some spinoffs now, and I'm not gonna say it's like obscure within the Dixon fandom, but she is so known for the Ice Planet Barbarian series that I'm like, her Corsairs are awesome too. They're basically space pirates rescuing human women and falling in love with them. You get space pirates, it's great, it's fun, and yeah, it's a different version of a sci-fi romance from her, and I think that they're really fun stories. They get a little samey, but I like the way that they're samey, so it's fine. So that to me is her underhyped series. And those are some of the underhyped series that I have read in the end of 2019 through 2020. Like I said, some of these I think are not like obscure. I just wish that they had gotten even more love. I think all of these are books that deserve even more eyeballs on them. So yeah, hopefully there's something in there that I have convinced somebody to read because I want these books to find audiences. So let me know what you thought of any of the books I talked about today, or let me know what one of your favorite underhyped books of recent years has been. And yeah, I think that that will do it for me. So if you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, follow me on the social medias if you are so inclined. I have all that information listed in the description box below, and I think that that will do it. I hope you're having an absolutely lovely day today, and I will just talk to you soon. Bye!